This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, good morning, students.
Good morning, sir.
Okay, okay, fine. We covered quite a few topics in natural part of A&T. Now we'll heading on to the next topic, epistaxis. It is both important topic, both clinical point of view and exam point of view, because you will be encountering a lot of patients having a complaint of bleeding from the nose. Okay, just being an undergraduate, you should make sure that you should have enough knowledge about epistaxis and before moving on the patient to the primary care, you should just ensure giving first aid at least. Okay, we'll start now the topic epistaxis. So this term epistaxis came from the origin Greek term epistaxo, which means to bleed from the nose. So this anatomy of the nose, which is may not be relevant now, but there are two points I want to depict now. See, this is the anatomy of the nose, external view. See here, you can see this is a bony region and this is a cartilaginous region. Okay, and see, this is these are both known as ala of the nose, because we have being undergraduate, you should know what is the ala of the nose. So I am showing here, which is which may be useful for a primary care, ala of the nose. And if the cartilaginous part of the anatomy of the nose, I mean external nose, is removed, what we see an opening here is known as piriform aperture. This term will be encountered in the next slide. So I am depicting here ala of the nose. Make sure what is ala of the nose here, and columella, this thing in the center part, converging point of both ala of the nose in the center, is known as the columella of the nose. And this bony architecture, external framework, this is a bony region and this is a cartilaginous region. If you remove entire cartilaginous part, you will see an opening here in the skull. If you just imagine a skull without any cartilaginous region, just bony part of the skull, you see an opening which is seen here. That opening is nothing but piriform aperture. So these terms are important in the future slides. So I'm just depicting here ala of the nose, columella, where I'm pointing here, and this region, this opening here, is known as piriform aperture. So now coming to the question, why nose is more vulnerable for getting bleeding? So there are very various parts in the body, but frequently we'll be getting the complaint bleeding from the nose, that is epistaxis, because it is a this nose is situated in a vulnerable position as it protrudes on the face. See, if you see the position of the nose, it will be like a protruding position. It is easily vulnerable. What if this vulnerable means? It is prone for getting, if you see in most of the movies or in the outside, if any want to kick on your face, he will just punch his fist on our face, especially in the nasal region, because it is a projecting part of our face. Apart from that trauma, if any person falls on the ground or hits something, the one part which projects outside is the nose, and it is easily accessible for trauma or injury, either by falling or any hitting like this. So other region is, it has a very rich blood supply. Very rich blood supply means mostly it is supplied by both external carotid and internal carotid. We'll be dealing less later which external part and which internal part. So it is both has a rich vascular supply. Both internal and external carotid arteries will be supplying the nose and forming anastomosis. So another reason for having epistaxis, I mean, what are the possibilities? Because the vasculature runs just under the mucosa. Because if you compare other parts of our body, it is covered by the skin. So whereas in our nose, it is covered just by mucosa, especially the septal part and lateral wall of the nose, nasopharynx, everything. is just supply just covered by the just mucous membrane. So at this mucous membrane will be prone for getting the effect of extremes of temperature. That is, so under region is this exposed mucosa will be under the effect of inspiratory current, which may be either due to extremes of cold or extremes of hotness. So this is the reason why most patients or most people will be getting bleeding from the nose, especially during our extreme winter region or extreme hot region. So because the drying effect of the air which passes through our nose causes the damage to the mucosa, and this vasculature which is just beneath the mucosa, which is not protected by epithelium as in the other case of a body, she is prone for getting injury. So now coming to the epidemiology or incidence of epistaxis or bleeding for patients. So this lifelong incidence of epistaxis in general population is 60%. What does this lifelong incidence mean? If you take 100 people, there is 60 people may get bleeding at any point of their lifetime, either from birth to death. 60 patients out of 100, there is an incidence of getting epistaxis or bleed from nose. Either it may be small, a drop, or a profuse bleeding. So incidence is 60%. But even among these 60%, that those who seek medical attention is almost less than 60%. Now coming to the distribution, age distribution, this epistaxis has a bimodal distribution. Bimodal means it occurs both in children, especially it is more common in younger children less than 16 years. It is also more common among greater than 16 years. Among greater than 16 years, it is mostly seen in 15 to 80 years age group, adult group or older group. In younger children, it is more common in 2 to 10 years age group. So coming to the sex distribution, it is common among males rather than females. There is a specific reason for that we'll be depicting further in the slides. As I said in the previous slide, why the nose is more prone for getting bleeding is it is supplied both by one of the region is it is both supplied by internal carotid artery and external carotid artery. So external carotid artery has numerous branches. There are almost about 8 branches. Among the 8 branches of external carotid artery, only 2 arteries supply the nasal part. What are those 2 arteries? Maxillary artery and facial artery. And among the internal carotid artery branches, the branch which supplies the nose is ophthalmic artery. So you should remember these 3 arteries: ophthalmic artery from the internal carotid artery, maxillary artery and facial artery from external carotid artery. These are the main principal branches. There are subdivisions from these main branches. So now the branches of ophthalmic artery are anterior ethmoidal artery and posterior ethmoidal artery. So from the internal carotid ophthalmic artery and from the ophthalmic artery anterior and posterior ethmoidal arteries will arise. Now among the two parts, among the two arteries of the external carotid, maxillary and facial, those also have branches. Maxillary artery will be giving 2 branches, greater palatine artery and sphenopalatine artery. And from the facial artery, you will be having 3 branches: superior labial artery, ascending palatine artery, and lateral nasal artery. So among these 3, these subdivisions are important because these are the arteries which will be forming some plexus in the nasal region or nasal cavity region, especially the septum and the lateral wall of the nose. So these arteries subdivisions should be kept in mind. Ophthalmic artery, anterior ethmoidal and posterior ethmoidal, from the external carotid branches, greater palatine, sphenopalatine, superior labial and ascending palatine. So see here, you can see the picture here. This is a nasal septum, which is seen from here. See, you can see the anterior ethmoidal artery and posterior ethmoidal artery coming from above, because these are the branches of ophthalmic artery, which is a branch of internal carotid artery. Ophthalmic artery arising from the orbit. So it will be arising from above. Sphenopalatine artery, as I said, it is a branch of this internal maxillary artery, which will be present in the posterior wall of the maxilla. This is a maxillary sinus, right? In the maxilla, we'll be having different walls. In the posterior wall of maxilla, behind the posterior wall of maxilla, you will be having internal maxillary artery. From this internal maxillary artery, you will be seeing arising this sphenopalatine artery. which will be going on the anterior face of the sphenoid. This is the sphenoid sinus. You will be running around the anterior face of the sphenoid, and you will be dividing into branches, lateral nasal and posterior nasal branches. Apart from these, other branches from the facial artery are superior labial artery. Labium means lip superior. It will be going from the labium lip, it will be going into the nose. Along with that, greater palatine artery. This is the palate region, and this is the greater palatine. This picture is very, very important because you may get 2 marks question or 4 marks question. So, and you can see all the blood vessels which are coming from above or behind or from the inferior side, all will be forming a plexus here. This plexus is nothing but Kissel-Back's plexus. Kissel-Back's plexus, you may get a 2 marks question like this: what is Little's area or Kissel-Back's plexus? So you should not confuse, just draw a diagram like this, and these arteries, anterior ethmoid, posterior ethmoid, sphenopalatine, greater palatine, and superior labial arteries. So these arteries all converge in the anterior-inferior part of the septum. This is the septum. This is the posterior region where I am showing. This is the anterior region. In the anterior-inferior part, all these blood vessels will converge and form a plexus known as Little's area or Kissel-Back's plexus. This is a definitely a 2 marks question. Sometimes you may get a 4 marks question also. And now coming to the MCQ point of view, you may get a question. So for those who are interested for getting PG postgraduate, just briefly telling, which of the artery is not involved in Kissel-Back's plexus? You may get an MCQ like this: which of the artery is not involved in Kissel-Back's plexus or Little's area? There will be 3 options among these 5, and another one is from under. They will give some other artery, posterior pharyngeal artery or ascending pharyngeal artery, something like that, and give all 3 options among these. So you should opt the 4th one, which is not present in this. So it is both MCQ point of view also important question, as well as from 2 marks and 4 marks question. So now coming to the brief description of Kissel-Back's plexus, as I showed in the previous slide, it is also known as Little's area because it is first described by a scientist known as Little, from John Little, and later it is confirmed or postulated 1 year later by Kissel-Back's scientist named Kissel-Back, and later it was named as Kissel-Back's plexus, also known as Little's area. Where does this little area present to? It is the anterior-inferior part of the nasal septum. So what are the anastomosis arteries? As I said, anterior ethmoidal, posterior ethmoidal, sphenopalatine, greater palatine, and septal branch of superior labial. This is very, very important both in exam and viva point of view also. And now coming to the another plexus, which is, as apart from Kissel-Back's plexus, the other plexus is Udruff's plexus. So what this Udruff plexus means, as I said, this Little's area or Kissel-Back's plexus will be present in the nasal septum region, in the midline, either on left side or left, right side of the nasal septum it may present. But this Udruff plexus, which is seen on the lateral wall of the nose, see, this is the lateral wall of the nose. You will be having, as I said in the anatomy class, you will be having 3 turbinates and 3 meatuses: superior turbinate, middle turbinate, and inferior turbinate, and respective meatus in superior, middle, and inferior meatus. This Udruff plexus will be seen at the below the posterior end of inferior turbinate. So below the posterior end of inferior turbinate is nothing but the inferior meatus. So this Udruff plexus are seen on the lateral wall of the inferior meatus. You can also mention as lateral wall, below the lateral wall of inferior turbinate. So this, there will be anastomosis like this. Kissel-Back's plexus, there is an anastomosis in Udruff plexus also. What are the arteries which are involved in Udruff plexus? Is pharyngeal artery, posterior nasal artery, sphenopalatine artery, and posterior septal artery. These 4 branches are the important in forming plexus there. See, you may get also a question like this: which arteries are involved in Udruff plexus and which are not involved in Udruff plexus? Like this, you may get a MCQ also. This is both viva also important. See, you can see both here in the Kissel-Back's plexus and Udruff plexus, you have seen the sphenopalatine artery commonly. So this by this you may understood like this, now this sphenopalatine artery is a main artery which supplies the nasal cavity or nasal septum. So this sphenopalatine artery is an important artery supplying the nasal cavity. So this should be kept in mind. So you may get also if you're asked which is the main principal blood supply of nasal septum, if they asked name the blood principal blood vessel which supply the nasal cavity, you have to answer sphenopalatine artery. You may get in a viva or an MCQ. Hope you are going through what I'm saying. Okay, hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay, see this picture which is shown here. This is the anterior part of the septum here, nose. This is the Kesselbach's plexus, network of arteries in front of the nasal cavity. And if there is any bleeding from this Kesselbach's plexus or Little's area, the bleeding will be in forward, or it will be coming through the nostrils. So it bleeding from the nostrils. So this bleeding from Kesselbach's plexus is known as anterior epistaxis, or Little's area bleeding is anterior epistaxis. See here, you can see this Woodruff plexus here, which is present on the lateral part. If you see any bleeding from here, usually it goes behind into the throat region. See, you know, we have discussed about the arterial bleed like Woodruff plexus and Kesselbach's plexus. Another important venous bleeding is retrocolumellar vein. As I said, as I showed in the picture, columella, ala of the nose, and piriform aperture. This retrocolumellar vein means it is situated just behind the columella. That's why I showed what is columella there. So this is the columella region. It is just so this is the columella region. This retrocolumellar vein will be present just behind the columella. It will be passing vertically downward just behind the columella and entering the floor of the nose. See, it will be present behind the columella. It will be traveling along the floor of the nose and joining the lateral wall of the nose, forming the venous plexus. So this is also the common site of venous bleeding in young people. So if these young people or young children has a habit of pricking their nose, see, they will be having too much of nails and they will be pricking their nose like this. So if they have any itching or something like that. So this retrocolumellar vein is also a principal source of bleeding, not only Little's area. This Little's area is also prone for digital trauma, that means pinching of the nose or picking of the nose. Apart from this Little's area, you should be kept in mind retrocolumellar vein, which is a venous bleeding present behind the columella. So natural bleed, so by this you have to know that not only arterial bleed, venous bleed also contributes from the nose. So both venous and arterial bleed may come through the nose. Venous bleed is through retrocolumellar vein. Now coming to the pathophysiology of the epistaxis, so nothing but, as I said, why nose is more prone in the previous slide is nothing but then the mucosa, the vasculature or blood vessels, what we discussed so far, superior labial, ascending pharyngeal, or ethmoidal or sphenoidal, will just run just below the mucosa. There will be no covering of skin. So whenever this mucosa will be eroded, this vasculature or vessels will be exposed to directly to the environment, and they usually break and lead to epistaxis. So now coming to the classification, mainly it is classified into two types, anterior epistaxis and posterior epistaxis. So anterior epistaxis, see in the starting slide, I said what is piriform aperture. So in order to classify anterior epistaxis and posterior epistaxis based on anatomical region rather than clinical point of view, if you want to classify what is anterior and posterior, anterior epistaxis is nothing but bleeding anterior to the piriform aperture, and posterior epistaxis is bleeding posterior to the piriform aperture. As I said in the first slide, what is piriform aperture? And along with clinical classification, anterior epistaxis is nothing but those arising from the Little's area or anterior part of the septum. Either that is the Little's area or the anterior inferior part of the septum, or mucocutaneous junction or columella, everything, vestibular skin, those all comes under anterior epistaxis. Posterior epistaxis is nothing but nasal cavity proper or lateral nasal wall or posterior end of the septum, all comes under posterior epistaxis. So now coming to the frequency of anterior and posterior classification, most of the bleeds, what we see in the clinical practice, are nothing but anterior epistaxis. So 80 to 90% of the cases are anterior epistaxis, which is the Little's area formed by also forming the Kesselbach's plexus. This anterior epistaxis is most commonly seen in younger age group because these children are more prone for getting digital trauma or accidental trauma. So this anterior epistaxis is more common young children. This is typically less severe. Compared to the posterior epistaxis, the severity of the anterior epistaxis is lesser and easily controllable because we can see just by inspecting the nose, by lifting the nose and by using nasal cuticle speculum or headlight, you can just visualize the spot where bleeding is coming from. So it is easy to manage compared to the posterior epistaxis. Now coming to the posterior epistaxis, as I said, it is behind the piriform aperture and nasal cavity proper or lateral nasal wall, anywhere it may arise. It is mostly seen in older population compared to the anterior epistaxis. And in the severity point of view, this posterior epistaxis is profuse, not mild as in the case of anterior epistaxis, and it is also will be prolonged and more difficult to control. And as I said, this posterior epistaxis will be trickling down the throat. It will be going back into the throat so that whenever the patient blood will be coming into the oral cavity, it will be spilled outside from the mouth. As it is arising from the nose, posterior part of the nose, again, it will may come out through both the nostrils or through the mouth. So you have to suspect if both the nostrils are involved, not from the single nostril, and if the bleeding is profuse and it also coming from the mouth and this all indicates that the bleeding may be from the posterior epistaxis or posterior region of the nasal cavity rather than anterior part, especially in the old population. So brief differences between anterior and epistaxis. It is also important if you given any question like epistaxis, you should definitely mention what is anterior epistaxis and posterior epistaxis. Just depict a tabular form and just mention these four points, you will be giving the four marks. So anterior epistaxis is nothing but it is more common. As I said, it is posterior epistaxis less common. It is mostly from the Little's area or anterior-inferior part of the septum. This posterior epistaxis may be from posterior part of the septum or lateral nasal wall. And anterior epistaxis usually in children and adults, and posterior epistaxis in old age group. It is these both are easy to remember. Anterior epistaxis mostly due to digital trauma or accidental trauma, and posterior epistaxis is usually spontaneous bleed and often due to hypotension or arteriosclerosis or atherosclerosis. So this is the reason why we will be getting posterior epistaxis after 40 years or 50 years of age, because this posterior epistaxis mostly due to hypotension or arteriosclerosis. What exactly happens in hypotension or atherosclerosis, if anyone asks, hypertension is having, why you should get bleeding in posterior patients, is the blood vessels surrounding in the posterior part of the nasal cavity will be having less muscular tissue to contract. So that if the pressure in the blood vessels in the posterior part of the nasal cavity increase as a result of hypertension or increased blood pressure, these blood vessels are easy to rupture and cause bleeding. So and apart from this, anterior epistaxis is usually mild in kind, easily controlled by local pressure or anterior back, which will be discussed later. And this posterior epistaxis bleeding is severe and requires hospitalization or posterior back. Now coming to the etiology and types of epistaxis, as I said in the previous clinical classification, both anterior and epistaxis depending upon the site. And another type is primary and secondary. What does this primary and secondary mean? Is primary means there is no evident cause. The cause is idiopathic. So it is idiopathic and spontaneous bleed from the patient. There will be no history. The bleeding will be spontaneous. There will be no cause. Secondary means if the patient is having underlying causes like trauma, either it may be digital trauma or surgery or any diseases, either systemic or local diseases, it is comes under secondary causes. So secondary bleeding, secondary epistaxis or primary epistaxis. Now coming to the etiology, it can be categorized into three types. local, systemic, or idiopathic. Local means in the nose and nasopharynx. Any pathology in the nose and nasopharynx comes under local. Systemic means either cardiovascular causes or hemophilic causes or anything, or bleeding factor causes, everything comes under systemic causes. And third one is idiopathic. Idiopathic means the cause is unknown. This comes under primary. In this point of view, I will be saying there are multiple causes of local causes, systemic causes, multiple causes. But if anyone asks like this, what is the most common cause for epistaxis? The answer should be idiopathic. Make sure the answer should be idiopathic. There is a lot of list here depicting this. There are causes of infection, foreign bodies, everything, systemic cause, everything. But either in exam point of view or wider point of view, if anyone asks what is the most common cause for epistaxis, the answer should be idiopathic, which is nine, but primary epistaxis. You may get also a question in the MCQ, which is the most common cause for epistaxis. The answer, the options may be this atrophic rhinitis or hemangioma or bleeding disorders or idiopathic. If the answer, you should not confuse. You may get a question like this. I mean, you may confuse. Hemophilias are more prone for getting bleeding, no? So we should opt that, but that should not be like that. The answer should be idiopathic. So now coming to the etiology proper, now we'll be going to the local causes. Local causes again divided into nose and nasopharynx. In the nose, the most common cause is the trauma. Trauma means, as I said, digital trauma, pinching of the nose or direct trauma, everything. And another second most common is infections. It may be either acute or chronic. Infections, why infections cause bleeding is, as I said, this vasculature is more prone or just under the mucosa. So if there is infection, there will be rich vascular supply. The blood vessels will be congested and dilated. So even there are more prone for injury in those congested and dilated state of the nasal cavity. So if there is any minor trauma which aggravates the dilated blood vessels, so the bleeding will be continuous and will be occurring, especially in the children. So in order to prevent bleeding in those type of situations, if you get any cold, you should seek medical attention or tablets or sprays used so that the nasal discharge or complaint or nasal infection should be controlled in order to prevent bleeding. So another is foreign bodies. Foreign bodies may be non-living or living. And another cause may be neoplasms of the nose and paranasal sinuses. So these neoplasms may be of two types, benign and malignant. Benign may be hemangiomas and juvenile nasal JNA, also known as juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma, papillomas, everything. Malignants may be carcinomas or sarcomas. Atmospheric changes, high altitudes and sudden decompression. These leads to changes in the vasculature, blood supply, and may lead to bleeding. And apart from these, as I said, extremes of temperature, like extreme cold, which is especially dry air, or extreme cold or extreme hotness lead to bleeding. And another is anatomical abnormalities like deviated nasal septum. Especially this deviated nasal septum, if it is presented like in the form of a projection, like spur, you may also get a bleeding from the nose. And another thing is nasopharyngeal causes, which may be due to adenoiditis, JNA, malignant tumors, everything like this. So adenoiditis, itis means inflammation. Any inflammatory tissue is prone for getting bleeding. So that especially this is not covered by the mucous, skin, especially in the mucous membrane regions. Another is juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma, which is most commonly seen in younger age group, especially male. See, if any male patient presenting with, especially 17 to 18 years male patient presenting with a recurrent epistaxis, you should have a diagnosis or you should have a suspicion that the patient may be a JNA, juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. You may get also MCQ in the postgraduate entrance. So a 17 year male patient presenting with a nasal obstruction and recurrent epistaxis, if you see JNA is the option, you should blindly opt for that. So it is rarely seen in females. So that male patient, younger age group, nasal obstruction, and recurrent epistaxis all point towards JNA. And this JNA is also important in for four marks point exam, especially for PGs rather than UGs. UGs may get also 2 marks question if the examiner is interested. So now coming to the general causes, it may be either due to cardiovascular system, hypertension and arteriosclerosis. As I said, this hypertension and arteriosclerosis, the reason why I said is the pressure in the blood vessels will increase. This muscular tissue surrounding the blood vessels in the posterior part of the nasal cavity can't contain that pressure, and this they may rupture, leading to bleeding, especially in the posterior part of the nose. So this hypertension and arteriosclerosis are the common cause for bleeding in the older age group. Apart from serious causes, disorders of the blood and blood vessels, that is coagulopathy disorders, like hemophilias, von Willebrand diseases, all comes under these disorders of blood and blood vessels. They may also present as epistaxis, bleeding from the nose. And other reasons are liver disease and cirrhosis. Why? What is the link between this liver disease and hepatic cirrhosis is, as we all know, the clotting factors, the factors which are necessary for bleeding, stoppage of bleeding, less clotting of the blood are synthesizers in the liver. So 2, 7, 9, 10 especially will be synthesized exclusively in the liver. So if the patient is prone for getting liver disease, or the patient is having hepatic cirrhosis, everything, this clotting factors production will be decreased, so that the clotting factor tendency is will be decreased, so that patient is prone for getting bleeding. And this is the reason why alcoholics also are more prone for getting epistaxis. So if you see most of the emergency care department, emergencies or casualties, most of the time usually patients will be presenting in the presenting with epistaxis. At that time usually will be having or mostly they are chronic alcoholics, or at that time they may be having acute binge of alcohol. This alcohol binging also prevents the clotting factors to act properly, so that alcoholics or liver disease patients also prone for getting epistaxis due to clotting factor deficiency. So simple reason is clotting factor deficiency. This should be the answer. And the next one is chronic nephritis and kidney diseases, everything. And other comes is drugs. And among the drugs, there are multiple drugs which may lead to causing of bleeding from the nose. This is nothing but excessive use of salicylates and other analgesics, anticoagulant therapy. Salicylates are nothing but NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like ibuprofen, aciclofenac, diclofenac, everything. And aspirin also, like other analgesics and anticoagulants. Anticoagulants like warfarin, aspirin, clomidogrel, everything, heparin, everything also comes under anticoagulant therapy. These all leads to this bleeding tendency, or increase the tendency of getting bleeding from the nose. And other systemic causes, mediastinal compression. If there is any mass present in the mediastinum, if there will be reflex pressure increase in the nasal cavity, it may lead to engorgement of blood vessels, especially venous vasculature in the nose, and it may lead to bleeding from the nose. Apart from that, acute general infections, and another thing is vicarious menstruation or viscerous menstruation. It is nothing but epistaxis occurring at the time of menstruation. This is a Viva question, especially for students, easy graduates. What is vicarious menstruation means, especially that is in females, if there is having any menstruation, at that time they will be having bleeding from the nose. So especially if any female patient, as I said, this female patient, incidence of getting epistaxis in female patients is very less compared to the male patients. There are so many reasons for that. Apart from that, if any female patient comes with menstruation and epistaxis, you should consider as vicarious menstruation. It may stop once the menstruation stops. So it is because of the hormonal effect of the nose present. So another thing is idiopathic. As I said, many times the cause of epistaxis is not clear. This is MCQ, which is the most common cause, means idiopathic. So after coming to the etiology, how will you manage? How will you manage a patient presenting with epistaxis? First, you should go with the history. Hysteria should always follow this protocol, I mean, order like age of the patient, because anti-epistaxis more common in younger age group, post-epistaxis in more common in older age group. And other thing is onset, duration, severity, and frequency. Onset means acute onset or chronic onset. Chronic means slow, slowly, small, small drops, it is prolonging. And duration, severity, small in quantity or profuse in quantity. Frequency, how frequent it will be coming, the duration between the episodes of the bleeding. And another thing is bilateral or unilateral. Usually anterior epistaxis is most of the times unilateral. It will be present from the anterior part of the septum. This posterior epistaxis, being a posterior region, it may posterior or superior part, if the bleeding is from posterior or superior part, it may be from the bilateral. Both the nostrils, blood may be coming from the both the nostrils. And other history should be bleeding from the other sides, especially from the skin. And preceding factors should be exercise, sleep, migraine, trauma, aggravating and relieving factors, nasal discharge. Nasal discharge or nasal obstruction should also be inquired, because some patients, especially in tumors, or as I said in the previous slide, JNS, if the cause is from the nasal part, usually these patients will be having other symptoms like nasal discharge, nasal obstruction, everything, headache, all may be point out that some local pathology may be present. And other medical conditions like cardiovascular, liver problems or blood dyscrasia, everything should be encountered, should be asked in the history, medical conditions. And another thing is the current medications, what medications he is using, is the patient using, and is there any link between the medications and the severe and the bleeding now? So what typically, as I said in the previous slide, is NSAIDs, anticoagulant therapy, and those on topical steroid space. If any patient presenting with nasal discharge or nasal obstruction, usually we prefer giving topical steroid sprays. This prolonged usage of topical steroid sprays also may cause bleeding from the nose, especially by drying of the nasal mucosa. So this is a very important medication which may cause the prolonged use, and prolonged uses may cause epistaxis, this topical steroid sprays. Apart from this, smoking and drinking habits. Why smoking and drinking habits? Drinking is because it is due to clotting factor deficiency and ineffective function of clotting factors. And smoking, we know, smoking leads to vasoconstriction. So the blood vessels will become atherosclerotic and vasoconstricted in smoking. So that smoking and drinking habits also, public people with these habits are more prone for getting bleeding from the nose or bleeding tendencies. So other history should be previous epistaxis or recurrent bleeding or easy bruising. Recurrent bleeding, these questions should be especially asked, because previous epistaxis means if the patient is repeatedly getting epistaxis or episodes of bleeding from the nose, we should opt for blood profile like complete blood count, coagulation profile, or BT, blood bleeding time, clotting time, and factors, and platelet count. Everything should be done along with HB. Everything should be done if the patient is having repeated attacks of epistaxis. And recurrent bleeding, what does this recurrent bleeding mean? In the same episode or in the same period, the patient will be having multiple episodes. In the morning, he will be having bleeding, and after 2 days, he will be having bleeding, and after 3 to 4 days, he will be having recurrent bleeding. In this patient should be suspected, especially if he's having any coagulation disorders or any pathology in the nose, especially JNA, juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma, and HHT, which will be dealt in the next slide, hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. These are the causes for recurrent bleeding from the nose. And easy bruising. Easy bruising means any damage on the skin, there will be swelling or edema of the skin, which may be seen in HHT. And other history should be family history of bleeding disorders should be also be encountered. And now next comes the physical examination. Vital signs should be monitored, because it is bleeding from the nose means obviously the systemic volume or blood volume will be obviously decreased. And the compensatorily, the body tries to increase the heart rate, increase the blood pressure, everything will be happening. So that the vital signs should be monitored, like BP, pulse rate, heart rate, respiratory rate, everything should be monitored, saturation, everything should be monitored. Examination also includes nasal cavity, which may be due either due to headlight, pedicum, speculum, everything. Or by the endoscopy, which may be rigid, especially what we use in ENT is rigid endoscopy, either 0 degrees or 30 degrees. We will direct visualization of the nasal cavity with the endoscope. And fourth one is skin examination. In order to rule out certain syndromes or disorders, where skin examination or skin bruising should be ruled out. Now coming to the management proper, after thorough history and physical examination, the management proper includes both investigations and treatment. Investigations, as I said, it includes complete blood count, bleeding time, clotting time, this platelet count, everything, and if required, CT scan. But in the emergency situation, the treatment should be followed on mainly on the treatment part rather than investigation part. That sample may be sent in the meanwhile, but CT scan or X-ray PNS should be postponed further before having an active treatment. So now coming to the treatment part, as I said, this controls significant bleeding or hemodynamic instability before obtaining a lengthy history. So whenever a patient comes to the emergency department, we should concentrate on treatment part rather than a lengthy history or investigation. This should be kept in mind. So now, how will you manage? The first step there should be discussed in the following steps like this. The first step is a first aid and resuscitation, assessment of blood loss, and third one is a localizing the bleeding, and fourth one is the controlling of the bleeding, and fifth one is the prevention. These points should be kept in mind and should be ordered. So now comes to the first aid or resuscitation. So as this epistaxis is other like similar to that any trauma patients or road accident patients presenting with bleeding elsewhere, this epistaxis should also be considered like that, and you should address ABC. ABC means airway, breathing, and circulation should be maintained. So the first aid should be airway, breathing, and circulation. So and in the process of maintaining this ABC, the first thing is the neck should not be hyperextended to prevent blood flow. See, this in epistaxis, most of the time, as I said, it is anterior epistaxis. It will be coming through the nostril, no? So that the neck should not be hyperextended or extended like this. So that if you extend the nose or head like this, the blood will be going backwards into the stomach and possibly into the respiratory tract and may lead to aspiration. So that neck should not be hyperextended. And apart from this, breathing and circulation. Circulation means, as I said, vital signs should be monitored. And any bleeding patients, if there is a profuse bleeding, vital signs and any signs of shock like should be monitored. And any patient presenting with bleeding, profuse bleeding, especially should have an IV infusion instead kept and crystalloid. Crystalloid means a linear lactate or NS normal saline should be infused in order to maintain the systemic blood volume. This should not be neglected in any epistaxis patient. We should not concentrate just on packing or treatment and the local treatment or not like that. We should also concentrate on the vital signs in the meanwhile. We should have a large bore IV line and IV fluid should be run in order to maintain the circulation. If the bleeding is profuse or severe enough, like in JNA or HST, recurrent epistaxis patient, we should also make sure blood transfusion also may require in the subsequent days. So the coming to the first aid, what first aid before shifting on to the hospital or emergency department, if any patient or suspect presented with nasal bleeding, what you should do is, there is a technique known as Hippocratic technique. What is Hippocratic technique? As I said in the previous slide, I show what is ala of the nose. This ala of the nose is pinched like this or like this. So this pinching of the ala of the nose on both sides, either with the fingers or some instruments, and this pinching of ala of nose is known as Hippocratic technique. This is the first aid which is usually done in order to stop bleeding, especially in the anterior epistaxis, because anterior epistaxis is more common, especially in children. This pinching of the ala of the nose or Hippocratic technique. You may get a Viva question, what is Hippocratic technique? So pinching of the nose like this is a first aid or basic measure should be kept. And other part, apart from this, we should also make sure is keeping the eyes on the cheek part and the forehead region is also another measure in the first aid measure. Apart from pinching of the nose, we should eyes should be kept on the forehead and the cheek, which leads to vasodilation and causes the bleeding to subside. And this is also known as Trotter's method. If the patient is made to sit after pinching the nose in the forward position, not in the hyperextension position, this is known as Trotter's position or Hippocratic technique. There is a triad known as Trotter's triad, which is nothing but blood in the mouth should not be swallowed, mouth breathing should be allowed because we'll be pinching the nose, no? So mouth breathing should be allowed and pressure over the cartilaginous part of the nose or all of the nose, especially for 5 to 10 minutes. So next up will be the after initial assessment and maintaining the ABC, we should localize the bleeding from where the bleeding is coming. In order to localize the bleeding, where the bleeding is coming is, we should inspect either with the headlight or tudicum speculum. And we should, in order to inspect, we should have cotton rolls or pledgets soaked in anesthetic or vasoconstrictor solution. What is this? Anesthetic means lignocaine, or vasoconstrictor like normal nasal drops, adrenaline or xylometazoline, both may act as a vasoconstrictors. So these anesthetic and vasoconstrictor solutions are inserted into the nasal cavity to anesthetize and shrink the nasal mucosa. In order to inspect the inside of the nasal cavity, this pledget soaked in anesthetic vasoconstrictor solution should be used. And before inspecting, these solutions should be kept for at least minimum 10 to 15 minutes. And then visualize the nasal cavity with speculum and good light source. And another important point is suction of excess blood and clots in the nasal cavity should be done before any active treatment is done. This point is very, very important in clinical point of view, especially if you are having any suction apparatus. Before doing any nasal packing, you should suction the or aspirate the excess blood and clots in the nasal cavity. Why you should aspirate the excess blood and clots is, see, if in order to effectively reach the what we impregnate the drugs or pack, if in order to reach the effective region of the bleeding vessel, this blood clots acts as a barrier. I mean, it will obstruct reaching the blood vessel. So this blood clot should be removed. And another thing is, if you keep a pack in blood clots in situ, this pack will push the clots and this clot may accidentally aspirate it. So that in order to prevent those, any packing or any procedure, either anterior or nasal packs, be done before that, you should suction the excess blood and clots. And with this, if the bleeding is from original from middle area, it is easily visible. So here you can see the image. This is epistaxis from the Kieselbach plexus. You can see red spot here. This is the nasal septum anterior part region. See here, you can see this blood vessel sphenopalatine artery. This is the principal blood supply of nasal cavity. So next, if you can't see anything with the headlight, anything, then you should use endoscope in order to localize the bleeding. The endoscope should be rigid endoscope. Especially for localizing the posterior bleeding, this rigid endoscope is used. So next comes the control of the bleeding. The control of bleeding may be either direct or indirect therapy. Direct therapy means just application of vasoconstrictors, topical vasoconstrictors like xylometazoline. If you can see the bleeding spot in the nasal part of the septum, and then especially this silver nitrate, you can see here, this is matchstick like, just like matchbox. The sticks will be like matchbox. If you see any bleeding point in the nasal part of the septum, especially the anterior part, this silver nitrate is applied on that part so that bleeding is controlled. And make sure only one side should be cauterized when we use silver nitrate. This is known as chemical cauterization. So this point is a viva question. What is our MCQ point also, it is important. Chemical cauterization in the nasal bleeding is done with, you may get options. The answer should be silver nitrate. And another important clinical point is only one side should be cauterized. If you do chemical cautery on both sides at the same spot of the nasal septum, it will lead to septal necrosis and perforation. If you can't access to silver nitrate or chemical cautery, then bipolar cautery or electric cautery may be used under general anesthesia or local anesthesia. So that's if the direct therapy if won't work, then we should your bleeding vessel is not located, then anterior nasal patching should be done. This anterior nasal patching should be done either with petroleum jelly or an antibiotic ointment, especially mepirocin or soframycin. You should take at least a 1 meter cloth, especially 1 to 2 centimeters width, and this cloth or ribbon gauze should be rolled in petroleum jelly or antibiotic ointment and should be kept in the layers like this. First, you should keep on the floor, and by layer, it should go into the upwards using a forceps. And this anterior nasal packing should be kept minimum to 3 to 5 days. And if the patient should be on antibiotic cover also, if the anterior nasal packing is done, you should not remove and keep every day. But it may kept up to 3 to 5 days. But if it is kept to 3 to 5 days, it should be covered under antibiotic cover in order to prevent sinusitis, toxic shock syndrome, everything. And another anterior nasal pack material, this is mirocin. So it will be around 7 to 10 centimeters length. It should be kept in the nasal cavity, and either water or normal saline or any steroid solution may be impinged on, infiltrated or sprayed on that so that it will swell. It may also use for nasal packing. Now coming to the posterior nasal packing. So if there is a patient of high suspicion of posterior nasal bleed or bilateral bleed or bleeding coming from the posterior part of the nasal cavity or from the oral cavity also, especially in older people, we should do for posterior nasal packing. So posterior nasal packing, the previously this method is known as, that is the technique of posterior nasal pack. This Foley's catheter or any catheter size of 10 to 12 gauge is insert, is passed through the nose, and it will be removed from the oral cavity. In the meanwhile, we should prepare a ribbon gauze in the shape of a cone, rolled in the shape of a cone, and three threads to be tied to it, one on either end and in the middle. These either end threads should be tied to this Foley's catheter, and middle thread is left behind. So once this Foley's catheter, once inserted through the nose and passed through the oral cavity, it is pulled back through the nose so that it will be going. See, so Foley's catheter is passed like this into the nose, and through the oral cavity it is again passed outside like this. So this already prepared ribbon gauze in the shape of a cone having three threads is tied to this, and again this Foley's catheter is pulled again back. See the arrow here, it is again pulled back, and this so this tied ribbon gauze will be going into the coina, see, posterior region. By like this, the posterior pa nasal pack by gauze method is done, and this it is also if at all posterior nasal packing is done, it should be also supported by anterior nasal packing. Both should be done at the same time, and anteriorly this thread should be supported in order to prevent columella necrosis or skin damage. Last few slides. So another apart from Minocel, this is also known as a double balloon catheter, and another is a Foley's catheter. You can see even simply you can use a Foley's catheter by passing through the nose and infiltrate the solution there, so that Foley's catheter also can be used for these tests. Double balloon, the anterior balloon should be infiltrated from 20 to 30 ml, and posterior should be infiltrated for 10 to 15 ml, so that bleeding can be used stop. So after anterior and posterior packing, this next, if the bleeding is not controlled, you should can use ligation techniques like septal surgeries or embolization techniques or ligation. In the ligation part, arterial ligation, especially sphenopalatine artery, should be the first principal vessel should be ligated. Okay, which you may also get a question, which is the principal vessel ligated in epistaxis or uncontrolled bleeding? Is the answer should be sphenopalatine artery. Also endoscopic sphenopalatine artery ligation, ESPAL. If the bleeding is not controlled even with ligation, we should then go with angiography and vessel embolization. This is a picture of sphenopalatine artery ligation using the clips. And next comes the embolization. Embolization is nothing but under LVA angiography is done by passing a catheter through the femoral, and nasal circulation is identified or bleeding points are observed, and vinyl alcohol or tungsten are passed, and then embolization is done with polyvinyl alcohol or tungsten, everything like that. Before doing embolization, we should rule out any malformations, aneurysms and fistula, everything. And the efficacy is similar to almost ligation. It depends upon the those who are doing, the surgeon or everything like that. Another condition is HSP, hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. I'm just going fast because the time is over. Okay, it is also known as Osler-Weber-Rendu disease. In this patient also will be having recurrent epistaxis. So apart from this, aneurysms, telangiectasia, or skin bruising is also present. The treatment should be packing cautery, anterior fibrinolytics, estrogen, septal dermoplasty. Dermoplasty means the mucosa is replaced with a skin graft. In HSP, septal dermoplasty is one of the procedures. So it should be kept in mind. And if the last resort, if laser, even after laser is used, not done, controlled, Young's operation is a treatment of choice for HSP. So brief recap. How will you manage resuscitation and initial examination vessel? If the vessel is located, direct therapy like bipolar usually or cautery, silver nitrate can be used if the vessel is located by examination. If the vessel is not located by direct headlight examination, you can use endoscopy. Okay, even if endoscopy is done, vessel is not located, indirect therapy like anterior packs or posterior packing should be done. Even if anterior pack and posterior pack kept bleeding is not controlled, you should done with ligation or embolization. This is epistaxis, ladder, pressure, cautery with silver nitrate, anterior posterior, and everything. In order to prevent, final slide, the nasal saline sprays post packing or post discharge, nasal saline sprays are a must. It should be used 3 times a day. And you should also advise avoid hard nose blowing or sneezing. Avoid hot foods, stress activity, and sneezing with open mouth. Avoid nose picking, and all should be done. And complications of epistaxis nasal paxis will be rhinosinusitis, toxic shock syndrome, hypoxia. This is the reason why the posterior nasal packing patients always should be admitted and should be monitoring, telemetry. So these are the possible complications of nasal packing and epistaxis. Okay, thank you. Jyoti Prasad, the attendance, please.
Hello, sir.
Okay.